Apparently this guy don't need no introduction, but I will ask you, when it gets through, if everybody treat this like a wedding, remain seated. Go downstairs, as we all know, the book will be available in April, but we've got every book he's ever written, and some he's just written in, are downstairs here. And usually the book signings, we restrict it to our books, but anybody who's brought books, Rick said he'd be happy to sign your book, so bring them down. After he gets through reading from the new book, let us get through, he'll go downstairs and be ready to sign all books. And you guys will be the first ones in America to hear about the best cook in the world, and here's the best writer in the world, Rick Brown.
I met Jake about 30 years ago, and he was full of it then, and he is full of it now. It's good to see y'all, most of you actually, 50 times before. How are you?
I'm doing good. Are you? What page file?
Well, what we would like to see is you come out of your shell. Just
well, I'm
trying. Do I have a happy sign?
Now, you know what? I actually have, this is a true story. You know, usually when a Southerner says that, you need to really start rolling your pants. It's going to get deep. But I had somebody hand me a book at a book event, you know, one of them, like Southern Festival books or something like that, and where there were a bunch of folks there, and they handed me this book, and it didn't look like one of my books, and it was by, is it Rick Bass? and I said, ma'am, that ain't me. And she said, yes, it is. Several things go wrong. First I had that terrible cold that's going around, you know, and it actually scarred my vocal cords, which is why I have this gravelly, sexy nature.
You always had that.
Yeah.
You
know, And then I gave myself a haircut. And I've been cutting my own hair for, I also cut Jake's hair. But I've been cutting my own hair for 30 years, 35 years, and no, longer than that, 40 years. 40 years I've been cutting my own hair. And I did a pretty good job the first 39 years, and then it started to fall out, and the combination of it falling out and my barbering has created this chain gang look. It's really just pitiful, you know, although looking around the room, I feel a little better about myself. What I'd like to do, if it's okay with y'all, I'll talk just a little bit more, and I'll actually read a little bit from this book, which I have not done before. And I won't read much, because I found that in long book readings, people's butts just get numb, and they sit there and they look miserable, and you know, and it doesn't matter if it's like Thomas Wolfe reading it, and not that guy in the white suit, but the real one. I'm kind of proud of this. My mom got sick over the past 3 years, and she had a terrible bout with cancer, and she the doctors told her, you know, that it was a serious, very very serious thing, but that they believed that the surgery could be not only complete, but could spare her, you know, a lot of difficulty and indignity. And man, it all went beautifully. Now, it was a terribly traumatic thing, and she is still recovering. And but while she was sick, if that's her, tell her I'll be home. Everything's gonna tell her heading that way. But I asked her once, and we don't talk about the end of time. You know, we don't. I mean, the end of time means a different thing to the Congressional Holdings. The end of time doesn't mean you're dying. The end of time means everybody is. And then, of course, there's a whole other configuration going on. Most of my kinfolks will be ascending. Some of us, there is some question. But moving right along, so you wouldn't ever say to Mom, say, Mom, before we get any older, I'd like you to give me some of those recipes. We just don't say stuff like that. But I did ask her once. I said, I really would like to have that recipe for like beef short ribs. And I don't know if y'all do this, but Mom will take not those fancy rich folks beef short ribs you get at Highland Barn Grill and you have to take out a trailer payment. You know? I don't know if anybody actually ever has actually went from their trailer to I have lived in a trailer, and I can tell you that it was a step up. These are, you know, those little cheap short ribs. They're real fatty. Mama will put them in a boiler, and she doesn't really sear them the way a lot of people, chefs, will tell you. You sear your meat to seal in the flavor. Yeah. I think it's just because it looks good. But she would cook them down to near nothing. But she wouldn't use a lot of water. She would just use just enough water to cover, and she would... And, you know, chefs will tell you not to do this either, but she would slowly add water so that you never had a soupy, watery mess. You had this oily, delicious, you know, they would cook down and begin to caramelize, and she'd add a little more liquid to it. And then, when they were good and tender, falling off the bone tender, when she could pick up the bone and they would slip off, she would quarter... golden potatoes and have hot onions and put in there on top of it and cook it until the last of the liquid had cooked out. The onions had caramelized down in the bottom of the pot and the potatoes had just started to flake. Wow. You know, they weren't done. They were not that kind of mush. But because the liquid had been mostly cooked out, they would almost puff up. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And we skin our potatoes. We don't use the peel. We know the peel is supposed to be healthy. And my mama said, well, that can be healthy for the hogs. But anyway, I asked her for that recipe. And she said, well, honey, I've never written down a recipe. And it just occurred to me that while there might have been a cookbook gone through the house as a gift, it always wound up being sold at the yard sale for like a dime. And she had never written down a recipe. She'd never cooked from a recipe. She learned how to cook from ghosts. She learned how to cook from people who... She learned how to cook like we talked about it at the truck stop at Red's. It was a barbecue place, but it had a truck stop feel to it. And, you know, at Red's Barbecue, she learned how to cook slinging hamburgers. She learned how to cook standing over a pot of pinto beans because she was the cook on the work crew. That the cotton pickers would come to her house at lunchtime. And then when the food was done and everyone had eaten, she'd go back with them to the field and pick back the day. So this is where she learned to cook. But the way our people learn to cook, it's a wonderful story, and it's in here. This is a, you call it a food memoir, I guess, but it is the history of how she learned to cook. So it has to go back generations before her. And our people learned to cook this way, as far back as we can go. My grandfather, and y'all read about her, my grandfather married a woman named Ava Hamilton. And Charlie Bunner married Ava. And Ava essentially lied and told him that she could cook. And her sisters prepared a box lunch. Her sisters did, that he purchased, and yeah, they danced and, you know, and had a good time, and he ate the box lunch and thought, my God, this is the perfect woman for me, and he stole her away, and all that's a wonderful story, except it was all a lie, and she was that kind of little bitty skinny woman that didn't like food anyway, so she saw no value in food. And he swung a hammer, you know. They could eat like a 5-gallon bucket of soup. And imagine his disappointment. Because not only could she not cook hearty food, she saw no reason for seasoning. And he couldn't take it anymore. He lost weight. And one day he got on his mule. And he rode into the foothills of the Appalachians, across the Georgia line, up into those high, deep mountains. And back at the turn of the last century, it was a different world. The rough, hard place. And he was on muleback. And he was searching for his father, who had been run out of the state because he had... Well, it depends on which story you believe, but he'd either badly cut a man or killed him. And Jimmy Jim Bunner was his name. He's my great-grandpa. And he fled into those mountains. And while he was gone, many terrible things happened. The wife and child died. His son married a woman who couldn't cook. Many terrible things occurred. And then one day up rides his son on this gray mule. We know it was gray because we asked. And the boy looks down. He sees this old man squatting beside this fire. Rough looking old man. In rags and sitting by this, literally by a cabin lean-to. And said, and the man looks at him and says, boy, he looked half starved, and he said, I am daddy, for I have married a pretty woman who cannot cook. And I believe that I am starving to death, and you have to go with me. And he didn't give him an answer right then. They spent the night, and the next morning he just crawled up behind him on muleback, and they rode down the mountain. And he had to teach my grandma how to cook. He had learned on chain gangs, on timber camps. He knew how to cook food that tasted good. He learned how to cook for people that cut your head off if you just My grandma, unfortunately, is not the most even-tempered person. And they almost killed each other. And at one point, my grandma, and this is the beginning of the chapter, actually went looking for a well to push him down. So this is, you know, this is the nature, but it does have honest to God recipes in it. And did you help me on this one, or did you help me on Jerry Lee? You helped me on the Doug, huh? Well, good, because the royalties are about worn out. I didn't think on the other one, though, so that's okay. I'll read you just the first couple. Since she was 11 years old, even if all she had to work with was neck bones, pepper grass, or poke salad, she put good food on a plate. She cooked for dead broke uncles, hungover brothers, shade tree mechanics, faith healers, dice shooters, hairdressers, pipe fitters, crop dusters, high steel walkers, and well diggers. She cooked for iron workers, Avon ladies, highway patrolmen, sweatshops, seamstresses, fortune tellers, coal haulers, dirt track daredevils, and dinosaur girls. She cooked for lost souls stumbling home from Aunt Hattie's beer joint and for singing cowboys on the AM radio. She cooked in her first 8 years more than 70,000 meals, as basic as hot buttered biscuits with pear preserves or muscadine jelly, and as exotic as tender braised beef chop and white milk gravy, in kitchens where the only ventilation was the banging of the screen door. She cooked for people she just as soon poisoned, and for the loves of her life. She cooked for the rich ladies in town, melting beef short ribs and potatoes and Spanish onions and other woman's baby on her hip, and sleepwalked home to feed her own boys home canned blackberries dusted in sugar as a late night snack. She pan-fried chicken in Red's barbecue with a crust so crisp and thin it was mostly in the imagination, and deep-fried fresh brown and crappie and hush puppies red alone with green onion and government cheese. She seasoned pinto beans with ham bone and baked crackling cornbread for old women who tugged the cotton sack, and stewed fat spare ribs and creamy butter beans that truck drivers would brag on 3,000 miles from home. She spiked collard greens with cane sugar and hot pepper for old men who fought the Hun on the Hindenburg line, and simmered chicken and dumplings for mill workers with cotton mints still stuck in their hair. She fried thin apple pies in white butter and cinnamon for pretty young women with a bus ticket out of this one horse town, and baked sweet potato cobbler for the grimy pipe fitters and dusty bricklayers they left behind. She cooked for big-haired waitresses at the Fuzzy Duck Lounge, shiny-eyed pilgrims at the Pentecostal summer campground, and crew-cut teenage boys who read comic books beside her banana pudding, then embarked for Vietnam. She cooked most of all to make it taste good, to make every chip melamine plate a poor man's banquet. Because how do you serve dull food to people such as this? She became famous for it, became the best cook in the world, if the world ends just this side of Cedar Town. But she never used a cookbook, not in her life. She never cooked from a written recipe of any kind and never wrote down one of her own. She cooked with ghosts at her sure right hand, and you can believe that or not. The people who taught her the secrets of Southern blue-collar cooking are gone now, and they did not cook from a book either. Most of them did not know how to read and write. Every time the old woman stepped from her workshop of steel spoons, iron skillets, and blackened pots, all she knew about the food left with her in the way when the bird flies off a wire, it leaves only a black line on the sky. Thank y'all. You sure it's not with you? Before we take a question, there is my favorite Jake Reese story. It says, Jake is a notorious liar. And he was introducing me. I won some award or something, right? And Jake was introducing me, and he said, "But most of all, I want you to know what kind of person Rick Bragg is." Well, I remember once at an event he went to, and it was jam packed, and there wasn't room for anybody to sit at, and there was this elderly lady in an electric wheelchair, and she could not get up the ramp to get into the venue, and he just walked up and said, "Ma'am, let me handle this for you," and bodily picked up the wheelchair and carried it through the double doors and deposited her in the prime location. And that's a wonderful story. Didn't happen. ski boot. There might have been some bodily picking up and moving in there, but he's full of crap. Are there any questions at all? You know, again, this is like church. So, yes, ma'am.
How did you get all the recipes? Did you just interview her?
Well, I had been a little sick myself, and so I had a rough 2 or 3 years. So, yeah, I sat beside her in our convalescence. I did some of them in the hospital. And then and I sat beside her and I said, how'd you do this? And it was hell. I mean, it was just sheer unadulterated hell because, I mean, yeah, I said, you know, well, how long did you cook it? Till it was done. how much sugar? Some. What the hell is some? a handful, a good handful. Which a good handful is a handful and a half. But her hands are small. So that was. So my point being that if you cook these recipes, I don't want to hear from anybody. Just look at it, make your best guess. You know, like poke salad. There should not be a recipe for poke salad because poke salad is a terrible thing. Yet, women of my mother's generation who, you know, walk along ditches of other people's property, you know, they think it's good stuff. And it, you know, it, you have to wash it 5 times, you got to cook it 3 times, then you fry it and you add an egg, and I'm convinced you add the egg so there'll be something in it. But the thing is, it's not a traditional. I'm sorry, I almost fell down. God, I'm that far gone, Jay. But there is it's not written like a cookbook. It is a biography of a cook, but it is tied tightly. And it's not just her. It goes, like I said, it goes back generations before her. And then she finally catches up with the narrative of cooking and becomes the center, the focus. But yeah, it was not. The stories were easy. You know, the stories have always been easy. They're there. You know, I knew some of these stories before I was 5 or 6 years old. But the recipes are a pain. And I did not have Southern Living. This book is by Knopf. I did not have Southern Living's test kitchen to, like, come in. So, you know, A, we don't want to poison anybody. B, I really don't want to hear from anybody. Well, I tried that, and it didn't have any taste. But the ringing endorsement was from this, like, one person who said, I cooked some of that stuff in there, and it turned out all right. That's not a ringing endorsement, either. But the food in it is, you know, again, pinto beans and ham. You know, pinto beans and ham, most people think that's pinto beans cooked with salt, a little sugar, just a little bit, just a tiny bit. And season with a ham bone or some ham. That's not pinto beans and ham. Pinto beans and ham is the bone with a lot of meat still left on it, the cartilage, the fat, and then the skin that was trimmed off the outside of the ham. So, yes, you've got a ham for, like, breakfast or for baking, but you have fat and skin and cartilage and bone all cooking together. And now to a lot of people, they would go, ooh. But not anybody who grew up like we did. Crackling cornbread. Well, instead of having just cooking cornbread, I had a great story about the rendering of lard. You know, so these stories were, again, the stories were easy. The rest of it, terribly hard. They didn't pay me enough, and they paid me a lot. Anybody else have anything? Anything else? I've been along, yes.
Did you convert all the recipes, like you said, a handful and a handful and a half, to like a cup and a half? Or did you leave that beautiful handful in there?
That would have been wonderful, except that then I would have had cooks in like Secaucus, New Jersey, killing entire families. So what I did was, no ma'am, the beauty of the language comes through, I believe, he said modestly. But I do believe this. I had to convert it. And believe me, that was hard, because I'm not a cook. You know, I'm not a cook. So, again, I don't want to hear from you. You know, I would like you instead, if you cook something and it is terrible, call Jake. And all the readers in America and the United Kingdom who might read this, and I'm pretty sure the French will want it, because you know how that is. They're going to also contact Jake. So, no, I wish I could have done that, and that would have been a great book. That would have been a great book, but it just wouldn't fly. So every chapter is a narrative, and in the narrative, toward the end, not necessarily the very end, but toward the end, is the recipe. But the recipe is written the way that we would say it. It's just that the measurements had to be in real arithmetic. So, and believe me, I didn't know what I was doing, and I admit that. So, you know, the editor in New York kind of just cowboyed up and said, well, I think this and I think that. And then they called me back. I said, yeah, that sounds good. I believe in exactness in literature. That's what we got. Does anybody else have a question? Yes, let me go here and then here. Just because.
What's your favorite recipe of mom's?
Yeah, the big one. White salt, cream sausage gravy with fresh cantaloupe, over hot biscuits with fresh cantaloupe. Pinto beans and ham is one of my favorites. Have you ever had a bologna, a smoked bologna sandwich, rag bologna barbecue? You get it Memphis everywhere. But if you ever want to know what it tastes like, go to like Neely's and get or even Simple Barbecue. They have a good one. And it's just about this much rag bologna smoked with, you know, smoked first, then sliced, then allowed to crisp a little on the grill. Not a lot, or you lose the juiciness of it. Then you got that hockey puck we all had as kids. My mama called them very, 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 very politically incorrectly. We called them Mexican hats, because they looked like little sombreros. But about that much, about that much on a soft white bun, hamburger bun, with a little barbecue sauce on top of that, and then fresh slaw. You know, like shredded, like purple cabbage slaw. Not shredded, not chopped, because it won't hold together. But shredded slaw with just mayonnaise and black pepper.
On the first day.
Yeah. Second day, you throw your slaw out. If you eat slaw on second day, you are a Philistine. Or you can go to Kentucky Fried Chicken and get last month's slaw. Yes, sir.
Any places outside the home that, while you're traveling, that kind of capture the same kind of?
Every place did. You know, I had I ate chicken on the streets of Port au Prince, Haiti, that had to be run down and plucked and cooked in a can of what I'm pretty sure was transmission fluid. the U.S. embargo was on, so it was very good. You know, I had, anywhere in the Caribbean you get roast pork. Tastes just like our roast pork. In Africa I had, good tastes a lot like venison to me. So in Central Asia, in Pakistan, Afghanistan border, I ate a lot of goat. I don't like goat. I just don't like goat, especially when you eat goat like 3 weeks in a row, nonstop, just goat, and then have some more goat. Then for supper, you'd have some goat. And I ate some very good chicken, but I don't like goat. Because I don't even like lamb chops, because lamb chops taste like goat. And goat tastes like pee. But I don't like pee. So, and I think that, you all right? But, I mean, really think about it. I mean, just think about it for a minute. What, before you eat it, just go like that. You will never eat lamb chop again. Anyone, someone else, while we're on this delicate train of thought. I tell you the best thing I ever had overseas was in the Dominican Republic, and it was the heart of palm, diced heart of palm with diced avocado and diced fresh tomato, just mounds of it, and then with a oil and vinegar dressing. It was full of garlic. The Cubans have a sauce called mojo, and it's garlic, lime juice, olive oil, and heaven. And but that on top of that was one of the best things overseas I ever had to eat. You know, and Irish breakfast is pretty good. You know, the Irish, you know, are kinsmen at best, at least. You know, so yeah, I love to eat. I used to bet, but nowhere do you eat better than at Margaret Bragg's house. You know, there's just not a better place. Let me do this one back here, and then we'll wrap her up. Yes, sir.
Did your mother have a favorite biscuit cutter?
Yeah, you obviously have had some biscuits cut. Have you ever had them cut with a snuff can?
Of course.
My mama does not believe in cutting biscuits. My mama pats out every biscuit and pats them out in her hand. You know, and we'll finish on this, because Jake would otherwise have to pay people overtime. And we just can't have that. The floor would split open and flames would lick up, and dogs and cats would start sleeping together. But what she does, she gets out her flour can, which is, it doesn't work if it's not beat to hell. And she puts the flour can between her knees on the floor. It's on the floor, and she sits, and she takes a depression in the can of flour itself. And then she makes the cone, inverted cone. And then my mama said, just say punched a hole in it. But anyway. And then she adds her liquid, half buttermilk, half water. And then self-rising flour is the best invention on earth. I mean, to my mom, she thinks it's just the best thing in the world. Some purists insist on that. And I understand that, but not if you're cooking for cotton mill workers. You know, you got to get it done. But anyway, and then she would pull the flour into the liquid until it looked right. And talk about measurements. How in the hell do you pound just till it looks right? And then she would pat them out and line them up, and there would always be one ugly biscuit. I don't know why the last one had to be ugly. I guess that she was tired. And then she would take her scoop, her sifter, and she would get the last of the flour that had been contaminated with the liquid. And she'd add that to the ugly biscuit. That was the dog biscuit. The dogs always got the ugly biscuit.
And does your mama use white lily?
She used white lily when in her childhood and in her youth. Now she, you know, when I asked her about it once, I kept getting the wrong kind, and I confused both of us, and now neither one of us can remember what was So I have failed her, just failed her, you know, in every way. But we'll wrap this up, because I don't want Jake to have to, like, take out a loan. But, you know, this, thank y'all, first of all, for coming. It is very unusual. Only Jake would think of a way to pick people's pockets 6 months before the book came out. I'd like to say I was against every minute. I was against it. But thank you for coming, and we'll go down and I'll sign whatever you have. I signed a baby once. I signed its little Lindsay with a Sharpie. Yeah, it'd be a lot better if I had, like, signed its forehead. That's just something my people do. But thank you, and I'll see y'all downstairs.